Oh, no, 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 no! Hey, guys, welcome back to Kerbal Space Program, where we are not quite ready to go to Juno. We are literally nearly there. The Kerbal alarm clock tells me we have 150 days left to go, which should be more than enough time to get this, the final fling, into space. So what we have up top is two capsules. We have our two backup pilot. Well, it's our backup pilot and backup scientist, Richmail and Raven. Raven is the hero of today's mission, but we will get into that. Just remember, Raven is the man to look out for. First, I would like to show how good Richmail is getting these close encounters on the go now. I had a little bit of practice at getting things up and close together in orbit, what with putting Ignis together here. And now Richmill's taken all that information and he's started to really get it down well of being able to meet up vessels within the first orbit. It's amazing. Just kind of throw ourselves up so our Apple apps and the close encounter marker are almost touching each other. And then through the process of getting myself into orbit, managed to trim down my encounter node until by the time I'm fully in orbit, my encounter node is as close as possible, which I think is an amazing feat. I'm quite proud of being able to do that. You can see I've not even done a full orbit yet, and we are within 16 kilometers there and getting closer all the time, because hey, who doesn't want to be close, eh? So now that we're up in orbit, it's time to make those final trimming and maneuvers that I was talking about. And in a rare display of patience from me here, we're going to go round an orbit just to get even closer than we can be. As people know, this is not something that I do very often. I'm much more into like spending all the rocket fuel so I don't have to wait around. But here we have a bit of an issue. So I decoupled my lifting stage here and was attempting to deorbit it through a burn when, unfortunately, I managed to run out of power. So it spiraled off into a higher orbit, thankfully putting it out of where we need to be, but that's a bit of an issue we need to deal with here. Okay, so the final fling is coming in for its final approach. We are within 5 kilometers here, and that's now enough for me to forget about what's going on in the orbital dynamics and just start getting as close as possible using my rendezvous technique, which is literally just, you see the yellow marker down there, I put that over the top of the pink one, I time warp forward a little bit, and then just repeat that process as much as I can. If I get too close, I'll turn around to my retrograde here, slow myself down using rockets. If I feel I'm going past too fast, I like to try and use monoprop where I can though, because it's the most inefficient fuel that I'm carrying with me, but also gives the finest detail possible. Anyway, you can see here we're approaching the Ignis, and we're trying to get within sort of 30 meters or so, because obviously we need to transfer some fuel across. If you remember back to last episode when we were putting Pi, the Ike rover, up here, I managed to use a little bit too much fuel. Again, my patience issues really came to bite me there. So what we need to do is transfer some of the fuel out of our stage here and take it over to Ignis, because we transferred the fuel tank out of the main fuel tank and over to all the auxiliary stuff. It was fun times, guys. You remember, orbital maintenance is of course what is all about in this game. Just trying to make sure everything works whilst we're up in orbit, because you know that's where we are. One thing that I found out that was quite nice here is if you get a Kerbal trying to link up, you can actually switch away from them if the two vessels are too far apart, and they will still have the fuel tank on their back, which is a boon. It's got to be said, it is an absolute boon. So right now we are taking Raven and we are trying to get him to put all the struts in place. Now you'll notice that I'm picking up a little bit of an oscillation here on my vessels. Now at the moment this is quite easy to sort out with a time warp. We go forwards a bit and stop, and obviously because when you're time warping, it doesn't process all the physics, it then cancels everything out and everything's all good. At least as far as I could tell at this moment in time, it may come back to bite me at some point, who knows? You know, this is Kerbal. Okay, so we've done some of the major strut attachments to try and get the rover and the probe attached, as they were the things that kind of stick out the most from the vessel. The next thing I really wanted to do was start thinking about how we're going to light up this vessel, because whilst this nice green light is amazing, it actually comes from the final fling. It's the working light that I installed so that the Kerbals could do stuff. So what I'm going to do now, I brought four lights up with me, and I'm going to attach them to the bottom engines here, and it appears to give a quite a nice lighting effect on Ignis, so we're going to go with that. I'm going to go put four around all the bottom, Yeah, because I love putting things around bottoms. And we will put more struts around. And I'm going to take a small jump forward because watching me just float around in space doing this, I mean, it was good for the first couple of minutes, but I think it's starting to wear a bit thin now. So with the final lights attached, all we need to do is take Riven back to the final thing and start thinking about how we're going to transfer fuel across. We have several fuels that we want to transfer. The easiest will, of course, be the liquid fuel, as everything just needs to go into the big tank in the middle, as I have previously mentioned in this episode. But the awkward one is going to be the monoprop. And this is awkward because, well, mainly it's because we've got lots of small tanks all the way around. So there's nowhere really that we can concentrate everything into a big tank, or at least concentrate the emptiness into a big tank. I don't know, can you concentrate emptiness? Is this a thing? I know we can concentrate fuel in one place, but can we concentrate the lack of fuel? I know, I'm going to go with that anyway. Answers on a postcard or in the comments, either way. But yes, so we're using the glorious technique that I believe came with the 0.9 update, where you can select multiple fuel tanks and then transfer out of one. So I just looked around and tried to find all the small monoprops that were empty, selected all of those, and then selected the big monoprop tank on the final fling to transfer everything out of that. And it worked incredibly well. And it took so long for me to explain that we've actually done all the fuel pumping now. So we've got Richmond out to go and get back this fuel node. That's what I'm going to call it. What is it? It's a pump point? I don't know what we should actually call it. And we're going to start flowing ourselves away from the Ignis because our work here is done. Not before we get to watch a glorious sunrise, though. We're just going to take a moment to appreciate that. Look at that. That's just... It's one of the most beautiful things that happens in this game, is the sun just coming up over the limb. So with the Ignis craft all done and strapped down, it's time to take part in the second part of the Final Flings mission. You'll remember during all the different launches, most of the launch stages I managed to get back down to Kerbin, but a few of them, through various reasons, didn't come back. Some of them were pointed, had their solar panels pointed in the wrong direction, so they ended up like just running out of power. Some even didn't have solar panels, and if you remember, the one for the Final Fling was so messed up that it pushed itself up into a higher orbit. All these things need to be dealt with. So we're going to go through the famous rendezvous technique. We're going to wait until we've gone just past the point of closest approach. We're going to use our maneuver nodes to make sure that our next orbit gets us in as close as possible. And here we can see us bringing an approach in. I believe this was the Dr. Hang probe. And indeed, the writing has just come up to confirm that. And once again, just going to use our rendezvous technique to get as close as possible. We no longer have to worry about the orbital mechanics, as I said before. So my plan for all these bits of debris is to get as close as possible using the final fling. Then we will transfer, well, not transfer, we will then use the square brackets to go across to that vessel and see what is missing to get itself back down. Now, it happened that this Dr. Hang, all it needed was a slight rearrangement of its position. I decided to go for something a little bit different, though, and we'll talk about that when we get a little bit closer. But yeah, this had solar panels on it. It was just one of the ones that happened to be facing the wrong way. Now, Riven, once again, cuts out and comes over and applies his scientific knowledge to start making things work properly. Now, I know that the Kerbal at the moment is behind Kerbin. So what we need to do is just put the solar panels facing the planet. And now we're just going to make sure that the final fling is not in the way. That was one thing that I was slightly worried about. Make sure that I wasn't in the retrograde burn of the orbit. And as soon as we have power, we're going to make the deorbiting burn on this lifting stage here and just crash it somewhere on the planet. I'm really not looking for maximum returns on the recovery here. What I'm really looking is to make sure that my band of orbit is safe so we don't blow up the Ignis in the 150 days we have to wait. It is a little bit annoying that every time I put one of these down, it all seems to explode. It's only the top half exploding. This again is all to do with a misbalance of the parachutes. So with the first bit of debris taken care of, it's time to move on to our next target. We need to come out to the map view to find out what that is, and I am literally just going to pick the closest one to my current orbital position. It means that we need to make the least change of my orbit to get round to the next one. Using the same technique as last time, found our closest approach marker, put a maneuver node on the other side of it, played around with that until the next closest approach was as close as I could possibly get. Performed the burn, had a look at our close approach. It was within 2 kilometers. That makes me a very happy man. If you are doing this for the first couple of times, do not feel you need to get that close. You can get within sort of 150 kilometers, stuff like that. And these are numbers that are good enough to play with. You then kill your velocity relative to that vehicle and point towards the purple marker and get in close, which is what I do from sort of 2 kilometers inwards. I like to use as little fuel as possible, so I make all my adjustments as far away in the orbit as possible, because, you know, that's how efficiency works in space. You do it as far away as possible and it gives the big deviation at the end of your orbit. So it's starting to get to the point now where my electric charge is starting to become an issue. Obviously, where I've had my lights on the whole way around my orbit, I just wasn't really thinking about it, and we were running down our electric charge faster than the sun could charge it up on the other side of our orbit, which is a little bit vexing, but, you know, these are the things we have to deal with in space. We have finite resources, and up in orbit, this is really what we need to be planning for, is the fact that we have finite resources. Okay, so Raven once again gets out and attaches one of the solar panels from the final fling to this new vessel that I believe this was the lifting mechanism for the Pi probe, the Ike probe, obviously. I'm not sure why I called it the Pi probe, PY. It was Pi Day at the time, and I was like, well, I don't want to be Pi, so we're going to go for PY. And yeah, struggling for names is one of the biggest issues that I have in Kerbal Space Program. And what type of naming conventions do you guys use? Yeah, I don't know. I try to steer away from the whole sort of Roman and Greek god things here. I have done it in the past, but it feels just a bit like, well, this is what everyone does in the real world. Can't we come up with something better? And obviously, no, I can't come up with anything better. But we managed to deorbit this main bulk thing here, and I was trying to use the 3 parachutes on top to bring this down in a nice flat manner. I managed to do it, and yet still the orange probe exploded. Not the orange probe, the orange fuel tank exploded, which is more than a little bit vexy. I mean, there were 9 parachutes on that. 9 parachutes, and that still was not enough to bring it down. It's, a wonder. Okay, so I'm starting to worry about the monoprop and fuel values on my final fling here. So I've decided to go for the big target in space, the very lifter that actually brought this vessel up. It has got flung out quite far, but it does actually come down at periapse to meet the same orbit as Ignus. And that means that it is the biggest threat to Ignus. It will have the biggest impact and take it out with the biggest consequences to deal with. So we're going to go around again using the maneuver node to make sure that we can get as close as possible, using the Kerbal alarm clock to great effect here. More than once in this little flight here, I'd managed to shoot past where I wanted to go, just fly past and watch these green markers just go whipping past me, and that's not great. So going to bust out the Kerbal alarm clock a bit more and make sure everything works out fine. As it turned out, doing this or in this orbit, I couldn't get close enough. If I did use that maneuver burn, what would have happened was I would have ended up crashing into Kerbin quite hard, actually. The orbit wasn't even halfway around the planet before it intersected the surface, so that wasn't great. I had to wait for an entire orbit, which, as you guys know, wow, waiting an entire orbit. But eventually we find ourselves in this situation here where we have an encounter with less than 2 kilometers, about 1.7 kilometers, though for some reason I just completely I don't know, I was just got far too overzealous on trying to move myself around. I went flying past it a couple of times, I had to turn around and come back. It's not very well put across in the video here, but as you can see, I'm doing a lot of trimming and a lot of stuff. I am actually on my second approach. I went flying past it, and I could tell by my instruments that I'd gone flying past, and that was just too much. And yet again, trying to use the time warp to just save myself a bit of time, once again went flying past it. I really should just learn to, like, get up and make myself a cup of tea in these situations or something, but nah, that's not how it's going to work. All right, so we're coming in within 30 kilometers here and just trying to nullify my speed so we can get Richmal out. No, it's not Richmal, Riven out to go and do a bit of work. We're going to take a second panel off of the final fling here and attach it to that last vessel. Unfortunately, this is not everything that needed to happen here. Not only did we need electric charge, but we also needed some fuel line. So what I was going to do, not fuel line, fuel, some fuel in there. So what I was going to do was turn the vessel around, make sure that the solar panel was still pointed in that direction, grab the pump point, bring it over and just slam it on the side here. I thought this mission would be quite easy here. All we needed to do was make sure everything was lined up in the right place, link everything together, and everything will be fine. Unfortunately, almost immediately, that happens. And I'm very, very disheartened here. I'm not sure what's going on. I cannot get anyone close to it or anything. And my closest quick save at the time was way before we had done any of this deorbiting stuff. So I wanted to try and fix this. Now, so I'd quick saved it. And my plan was to get Rich Mal out and just decouple everything as quick as possible. Unfortunately, as you can see here, I did this maybe a dozen times and I just couldn't get him out, get close enough, right click on the pump point and take it off in time. I was getting very stressed at this point. I thought everything that I had done was going to be for nothing. I wasn't going to be able to get this episode out in time. The keyboard had come up and got slammed onto my desk more than once during the production of this. Till eventually I just try and figure out how we can do it without using Rich Mal. It's just far too hard to try and get in there. Getting Rich Mal out seemed to be good enough to just kind of send the whole thing into wild oscillations. Trying to figure out if I could do it from within the vessel at all, no, I couldn't at all. Having a look at where Riven is, and as you can see, he was kilometers away at this point, which was a little bit annoying. But what we're going to do is we're going to go over to Riven, whatever his name is, sorry, and try and push ourselves closer towards. Now, unfortunately, here we've got no nav ball to work from, so I had no idea. Well, I had a rough idea where the vessel was in relation to me, but I didn't know if I was going directly towards it or if I was going a little bit towards. You'll see on my pack there that I used the fuel quite a lot trying to make sure that I get in close enough, and even then trying to nullify my speed was quite hard. Once I got close enough, I started doing a save and quick load. The whole thought process behind that is every time you quick load, all the relative velocities die out from each other because, you know, it doesn't store the physics in the quick save, thankfully, you know. Unfortunately, even this was not good enough, and I got the idea here that I just really wasn't going to be able to do it. So whilst I backed away a little bit to have a look at the vessel and figure out what was going on, thankfully, the final fling got flung away, which was amazing. Looking at it afterwards, the pipe endpoint actually sheared away from the vessel, which, to my mind, was possibly the best thing that could possibly have happened here. I was fully expecting the two to actually come together at quite a high rate, the lifting mechanism and the final fling to come together and just completely explode and kill Rich Mal, which was the thing that I was most worried about here. I mean, you all know that I'm quite attached to Rich Mal. He did an amazing thing on the moon. In fact, he is the moon man, if you will. But yeah, here we go. With everything done, I'm just going to trust that all those pushing aways and stuff got the probe there out of the way of Ignis's orbit. In fact, if we look hard enough, we can see that it is kilometers and kilometers in a bigger orbit on both its periaps and apoaps, which is great for me. And we're going to finally bring these two home. So the whole point of this was actually to get Riven some more experience, because he is a zero star scientist at the moment, and we need more stars than that on our scientists. With all the big three going off to Juno, we need backup here. And with that, I'm going to say thank you very much for joining me for this final adventure before we send Ignis off to Juno. I will see you next Monday, where we are going to do that. Bye!